So I will begin. Yesterday we considered an extreme form of Buddhist epistemology, which denies all means to knowledge at the level of ultimate truth. It accepts means to knowledge as belonging to conventional truth. But all that belongs to conventional truth is, after all, mental construction. It is superimposed on reality. This gives an impression that all so-called knowledge involves concepts, and because concepts are free human creations, they do not reveal the true nature of reality. But there were Buddhist philosophers who did not go to this extreme. They claimed that every piece of knowledge need not be conceptual. We can have and do have direct knowledge which is non-conceptual. In fact, non-conceptual awareness is basic to conceptualization. Hence, they accepted two kinds of knowledge: non-conceptual, which they called perception, pratyaksha, and conceptual, which they called inference, anumana. The prominent Buddhist philosophers who represent this trend are Dinnaga and Dharmakirti. Dinnaga and Dharmakirti are two pioneering figures of Buddhist epistemology. According to historians like Satishchandra Vidyabhushan, Dinnaga belongs to second half of the 5th century and first quarter of the 6th century AD, and Dharmakirti's period is said to be about 635 AD. It is roughly 5th century and 7th century. Dharmakirti is said to belong to teacher-disciple tradition of Dinnaga. Dinnaga had disciples like Shankar Swamin, who taught Dinnaga's epistemology to Dharmapala, and Dharmapala was the teacher of Dharmakirti. Dharmakirti is also said to have learned Dinnaga's epistemology thoroughly from another Dinnaga expert, namely Ishvara Sena. There is an oft-debated question whether Dharmakirti simply clarified and elaborated Dinnaga's epistemology and logic, or he also revised them radically. We will consider this question a little later. Before that, we will consider some common features of the epistemology of Dinnaga and Dharmakirti, which are important for us. According to Dinnaga-Dharmakirti epistemology, there are two forms of knowledge, direct and indirect. Direct knowledge is non-conceptual, non-constructive. Indirect knowledge is conceptual, constructive. Out of them, direct knowledge can be called pramana in the primary sense of the term, whereas indirect knowledge is pramana in the secondary sense, insofar as it is capable of leading to direct knowledge. Dinnaga-Dharmakirti conception of pramana is different from the nyaya conception in many ways. A few aspects of difference may be seen now. Nayayikas have instrument concept of pramana. Pramana, according to them, is the means to knowledge. The idea is that the knowledge as such does not change from pramana to pramana. That is, knowledge is something like a common goal of many pramanas. In perceptual knowledge also, we know substances, qualities, universals and motions, all these types of objects we can know through inference and verbal testimony also. This also gives us a uniform or homogeneous concept of knowledge. We have seen that while discussing perception, Nayayikas classify perception into judgmental and non-judgmental, savikalpaka and nirvikalpaka. They do not give the status of prama to non-judgmental perception. They accept that it is a kind of cognition, but they do not give it the status of prama. Judgmental perception has the status of prama. In fact, any knowledge, whether it is perceptual, inferential, or based on verbal testimony, is judgmental. It has qualification, qualified structure, vishesha, visheshana type of structure, according to nyaya. Buddhists, on the other hand, accepted a diverse and heterogeneous conception of knowledge. Though we call both perceptual and inferential knowledge as knowledge, their nature differs radically. Perceptual knowledge is non-judgmental, non-determinate awareness. Inferential knowledge, on the other hand, is essentially judgmental and determinative. Perceptual knowledge is non-conceptual, whereas inferential knowledge is conceptual. Hence, when the Buddhists, that is Dinnaga and Dharmakirti, say that there are two pramanas, perception and inference, they do not mean that the two pramanas are two different means leading to the common goal called knowledge. What they mean is that the two pramanas are two different kinds of knowledge. They rather stand for two different or heterogeneous conceptions of knowledge. This heterogeneity of knowledge makes it difficult for Buddhists to define pramana, because pramana, if it is pramana, is knowledge, but knowledge in the case of perception is not knowledge in the same sense in which knowledge in the case of inference is knowledge. So how to have a common definition of both these types of knowledge? This is a problem. They don't have a comparatively easy way guided by a correspondence theory of truth, according to which a cognition is prama if it has the same complexity as the reality it represents. So in reality there is a property bearer relation. In cognition also there is property bearer relation, and if they correspond to each other, then the cognition is true. This is the nyaya way, but this is not available to Buddhists, because either a true cognition has no complexity at all in the case of perception, or if it has, then the complexity of the cognition does not reflect the reality, but it is a mental construction superimposed on the reality. So in the case of judgmental perception, cognition has some kind of complexity, because in that we have dharma-dharmi relation. But corresponding to that complexity, in reality there is no complexity. The so-called dharma-dharmi relation is not a part of reality. In reality there are only particulars, svalakshanas. There are no samanya lakshanas. There are no universals. In cognition, there is this idea of property bearer and property. Both could be samanya lakshana in the case of inference, for example. But then corresponding to that, there is no property bearer relation in reality. So either a true cognition has no complexity at all, or if it has, then the complexity of the cognition does not reflect the reality, but it is a mental construction superimposed on the reality. Hence, Dinnaga gives classification of pramana, but does not define it. In Dinnaga's literature, we don't see the definition of pramana. Classification of pramana we see, that is, perception and inference are pramanas. This kind of statement we see. But what is the definition of pramana which is common to both? Dharmakirti faces this problem in Pramana Vartika, and he defines knowledge in negative terms as avisamvadi jnanam. Now, what Dharmakirti understands by the term avisamvadi, he does not say samvadi, jnana is samvadi, because if he says samvadi, then it is something like correspondence. Samvada means in accordance with, that is, cognition is in accordance with the reality, then it will be samvadi jnana. But he only says avisamvadi, that is, it is not discordant with the reality. So I translate avisamvadi as non-discordant. Dharmakirti defines pramana as non-discordant cognition. Here by the term non-discordant, he means non-discordant with the real object. Now, just in passing, because Rajendra Prasad has, a philosopher of India, he has a book on Dharmakirti, Dharmakirti's theory of inference, re-understanding and revaluation, or something like that. So in that he understands avisamvadi as non-contradictory, which is problematic. Now, Dharmakirti himself explains non-discordance means existence of the causal function of the object. Arthakriya sthitihi avisamvada. The idea in its simplified form is that the real object has a causal function. For example, real water has capacity to quench the thirst. Illusory water does not have that capacity. Real fire burns imaginary fire and does not burn. Now, suppose I see water, on what basis can we call the perception of water veridical? The cognition is veridical if it is about real water. On what basis can we say that the perceived water was real water? The water is real if it is capable of performing its function, that of quenching the thirst. Seeing mirage is not a case of veridical perception because the water seen in it is not real water, but fake water. On what basis can we say that it was not real water? It does not perform its function. It cannot be drunk, it cannot quench the thirst. Inferential knowledge can be explained on similar lines, but in a different way. When I see a line of smoke on the hill, I infer that there is fire on the hill. That is, I inferentially know that there is fire on the hill. In this cognition of fire, I do not cognize the real fire which is actually present on the hill. I cognize some indefinite fire, which is samanya lakshana, according to them, universal fire, fire in general. In Buddhist terms, I cognize universal fire, that is samanya lakshana fire. Universal fire is not real fire because it does not burn. Buddhists claim in general that objects are of two kinds, particular and universal. Particular is real because it performs a function. Universal is mentally constructed, it is imaginary, it does not do anything, it is unreal. Here Buddhists distinguish between the act of imagining or construction, which is a real mental act, and that which is imagined or constructed through it. That is, the act of imagining itself is not unreal, but what is imagined is unreal. So this distinction is between vikalpa, kalpana, this is a kind of cognition, and vikalpita or kalpita, parikalpita, these are the adjectives of object. That object which is kalpita, vikalpita, parikalpita is unreal, but kalpana itself is not unreal. The imagination, the act of imagining is not unreal. It is a kind of cognition. So mental construction is also a kind of cognition, it is real. But what is constructed in that cognition is not real. Inferential cognition falls in the category of imagining or constructing. As a cognitive act, it is real, but what it cognizes is not real. In inferential situation, this cognitive act is not only real, but it is also regarded as true. That is, as pramana type of cognition or right cognition, samyak jnana. That is because this cognition has a capacity to lead to the direct cognition or of a real object. So inference is pramana not because it shows the real object. It shows, what it shows is not real, but this cognition has a capacity to lead to the cognition of a real object. It has a capacity to lead to perception, which is a cognition of a real object. And for this reason, it is regarded as pramana. While explaining inferential situation, Dharmakirti uses the metaphor of an illusion which succeeds in giving the required result. This case is well known as the case of light of gem confused for a gem. Mani, mani prabha nyaya. The case can be presented as follows. There is a gem in the corner of a room. It is partly covered by a cloth, but the light emitted by it produces an appearance of the gem itself. Someone sees the light from the distance and takes it to be the gem. So light itself is confused for the gem. The person goes there and finds the real gem. So in this example, the person in fact, this example can be discussed in the context of Gettier problem. And I have discussed it in one of my papers, which is, I think, included in the reader collection, which has been given to you. So in this example, the person, in fact, mistook the light of the gem for gem. But he was under the impression that he had a veridical perception of the gem. And the veridicality of the perception is also confirmed by result, because when he goes there, he finds a gem. So he is continuously under the impression that he saw gem and he got the gem. But in fact, he did not see the gem. He only saw the light emitted by the gem. But because he got the gem, he said that I had a veridical perception. According to Dharmakirti, we have a similar situation in inference. What we cognize on the top of the hill is not real fire, but universal fire, which resembles fire, but is not fire. Even then, the inferential cognition is regarded as pramana, because when we go to the top of the hill, we obtain real fire. We may obtain, of course, it is not necessary that we obtain, because the fire could have been extinct by that time when we reached there. The Western conception of knowledge is primarily that of propositional knowledge. Similarly, the knowledge according to Nyaya, though it is not propositional in itself, has the same complexity as a subject-predicate sentence or a relational sentence would have. Knowledge in this sense can be said to have a propositional character. In Dharmakirti's scheme, however, perceptual knowledge is supposed to be non-judgmental or non-perceptual, whereas inferential knowledge can be called propositional knowledge. Out of the two, perceptual knowledge is supposed to be error-free, and hence knowledge in the primary sense, whereas inferential knowledge is regarded as error-ridden, and hence knowledge only in secondary sense. That is, some element of error is there in inferential knowledge, according to Dharmakirti, and also according to Dinnaga. Hence, Dharmakirti's theory of inferential knowledge can be looked upon as a comment on the Western epistemological tradition and the Nyaya tradition, in which knowledge is conceived as having propositional form. The comment would be that all the so-called judgmental knowledge contains an error element, in spite of which it is treated as pramana, because it regularly gives the required pragmatic result. So on the pragmatic ground, we regard it as pramana, but not on the basis of direct correspondence with reality. This challenges the absolute conception of knowledge, which is error excluding. According to the absolutistic conception of knowledge, it is always believed and hoped that the error, though it may occur in a cognition, can be recognized and corrected. Dharmakirti's approach to inferential knowledge, on the other hand, leads to an error including conception of knowledge. Accordingly, erroneous character which arises due to the involvement of universal is intrinsic to an inference. It is neither extrinsic nor accidental to it. With this discussion of Dinnaga Dharmakirti conception of knowledge, let us turn to their conceptions of the two types of knowledge, that is perception and inference. Here we find a kind of change or advancement when we go from Dinnaga to Dharmakirti. We will begin with Dinnaga's definition of pratyaksha, and then discuss its revision by Dharmakirti. Then we will discuss Dinnaga's conception of Anumana, and then its revision by Dharmakirti. That the last part we will discuss in the afternoon session, that is, revision of Dinnaga's conception of Anumana by Dharmakirti. Dinnaga defines perception as cognition devoid of conceptualization, pratyaksham kalpana podham, which is devoid of kalpana. That is the definition of pratyaksha. He immediately explains conceptualization. What is kalpana? Then he says nama, jati, etc. That is name, universe, all these are kalpanas. That is attributing a name to the object, attributing universal to the object. These are conceptualizations. And perception itself should not include any such conceptualization. In other words, perception is direct awareness of an object where we neither name the object nor interpret it by using a general concept. Having defined perception and conceptualization, Dinnaga explains what he calls pseudo-perception, pratyakshabhasa. Pseudo-perception appears to be perception, but it is not perception proper. Pseudo-perception is not perception proper because it involves conceptualization. So what are the cognitions which involve conceptualization and which sometimes appear as perception, but they cannot be regarded as perception? Dinnaga classifies pseudo-perception into three kinds. Illusions, such as that of mirage. Here the observer conceptualizes wave-like movements of rays in the desert as the waves of water. Then cognition of conventional reals, samvriti sat, in which the cognition projected conceptually projected entities such as substance, quality and universals are regarded as real. And third, inferential cognition, he calls it as a kind of pseudo-perception. For example, the cognition of fire on the hill, where the fire is conceptualized, though the particular fire is not seen. Dinnaga also includes the cognition resulting from inference, for example, of desirability of fire, for example, under this category. Now, Dinnaga's conceptions of perception and pseudo-perception indicate that perception can be erroneous only because of inclusion of concepts or mental constructs in it. If we analyze what we ordinarily call perception in two stages, namely sensation and interpretation, then Dinnaga is suggesting that error occurs only at the level of interpretation, not at the level of sensation. This view was not acceptable to Dharmakirti. He maintained that error is possible even at the level of sensation, independently of conceptualization. Dinnaga's definition of perception excludes error involving conceptualization, but it does not exclude the error in sensation. Dharmakirti pointed out that such a sensuous error or error in sensation can occur under different conditions. For example, a person having an eye disease perceives two moons in place of one. Then a torch moving fast in a circle causes an illusion of a round-shaped torch. Three, when we are traveling fast in a boat through a river, we see trees on both the banks running in opposite direction. And due to physiological disorder, one can get hallucinations. All these are, these erroneous perceptions, basically according to Dharmakirti, occurs at the level of sensation. Later on, at the level of interpretation also, they may continue. That is, we will have a wrong interpretation. But that does not mean that the error has occurred only at the level of interpretation. At the level of sensation, no error has occurred at all. Whereas in Dinnaga's framework, it seems that he was talking about error occurring only at the level of interpretation. At the level of sensation, no error occurs. Of course, this is a debated issue, and that is because of this Sutra Bhashya tradition. I will refer to that. In order to accommodate the exclusion of the sensuous error, Dharmakirti in his work Nyaya Bindu revised Dinnaga's definition of perception as: perception is a cognition which is devoid of conceptualization and is without sensuous error, that is, kalpana podham abhrantam pratyaksham. Pratyaksha is kalpana podha, devoid of kalpana, and also abhranta, which does not involve any brahma, bhranti. And this bhranti is something which occurs at the level of sensation. In fact, Dinnaga, while discussing pseudo-perception, had referred to illusion arising from eye disease. The disease which is called timira roga. So, taimira type of erroneous perception he talked about. But this did not lead him to revise the definition either of perception or pseudo-perception. the definitions continue to remain centered on the question of admixture or non-admixture with concepts. It was Dharmakirti who realized his defect and revised Dinnaga's definition. But an interesting point here is that Dharmakirti did not claim that he was revising Dinnaga. His general attitude was to protect Dinnaga, and even when he revised Dinnaga's position, he generally claimed that he was simply bringing the hidden meanings of Dinnaga's theory on surface. Here it is obvious that Dharmakirti did not simply continue the tradition of Dinnaga but developed it further. The question to be addressed here is, how is one to understand the development of Buddhist epistemology from Dinnaga to Dharmakirti? The following models come to the foreground. One is linear development. Sometimes Dharmakirti introduced new ideas or doctrines only as a part of elaboration and clarification of Dinnaga's theory and not in opposition to it. So, for example, if you just say that he defined knowledge, he defined pramana, which Dinnaga had not defined, that cannot be regarded as deviation from Dinnaga, but he was simply elaborating, explaining what was not clarified by Dinnaga. Then peripheral deviation. Dharmakirti did differ from Dinnaga on some details, but there was agreement at fundamental level. This is the claim made by many scholars, that actually there is no fundamental disagreement, only peripheral deviation. Then lastly, core deviation. Dharmakirti in his theory of inference deviated from Dinnaga. Differences in detail were the manifestations of this fundamental deviation. However, Dharmakirti generally avoided expressing the radical differences explicitly. So he did deviate from Dinnaga on some counts, and that deviation was fundamental deviation, and this we will see particularly in the case of inference, that his theory of inference is a radical departure from Dinnaga's theory of inference. But I mean, this is a debatable issue, and very few scholars would agree with me, probably. We find a tendency among modern scholars to explain Dharmakirti's development in terms of the first model, that is linear development, or at the most second model, peripheral deviation. B.K. Matilal seems to be taking the first kind of position. Satish Chandra Vidyabhushan seems to have taken the second type of position. He brings out the points of detail on which Dharmakirti criticizes Dinnaga, but these are only the points of detail, and not he does not go at the core, that here there is a basic or core at deviation at core level. The third model, the difference is not superficial but fundamental. However, sometimes we find that the advancement in Dharmakirti's epistemology cannot be captured by applying the first or the second model. The third possibility sometimes becomes stronger than the other two possibilities. This is more vividly seen when we consider their treatments of the second type of knowledge, namely inference. Here we will first discuss in brief Dinnaga's framework of inference and then discuss Dharmakirti's development over it. So in this lecture, we are now concentrating on Dinnaga's framework of inference. We have seen in the first lecture, that inference according to Indian tradition consists of the knowledge of the signified object based on the knowledge of the sign which signifies it. So that, I mean, the basic terms related to inference we have already discussed. In the case of inference of fire from smoke, the smoke is supposed to be the sign of fire, and fire is supposed to be signified by the smoke. Here both sign and signified are the properties of the hill. The sign can be called reason property. Now this terminology is used by Parimal Patil, a philosopher from Chicago, I think. And in his book Against a Hindu God, he has used this terminology, and personally I like this terminology, so I have started using it. Otherwise, there are different terms used by different scholars. For the basic terms are hetu, sadhya, or sometimes sadhana and sadhya also. And hetu, again hetu dharma, hetu is supposed to be a kind of property. Sadhya is also can be understood, sadhya can be understood as a kind of property, that is hetu dharma and sadhya dharma. So here I am translating them as reason property and target property, following Parimal Patil. But otherwise you will find different translations. For example, reason hetu is translated as probans, sadhya is translated as probandum, hetu is translated as sign, sadhya is translated as signified. I am preferring this translation, but you have to bear in mind that all these different translations are possible. Now the question is, what are the conditions which the reason property has to fulfill in order to lead to knowledge of the target property? As the answer to this question, Dinnaga presented his theory of the three features of the reason property. It is called the doctrine of trairupya, or triple character, doctrine of triple character of hetu, or triple character of the reason property. And what are the three characteristics or three features? Existence in the provable property bearer. What is provable property bearer? Is something like hill. Now these are just the examples, but there can be hundreds of examples. And there is a technique which we have to follow in order to understand any inference and examine that inference. So it is not possible to discuss all that, but I will try to give very basic things here. So existence in a provable property bearer, that the reason property which we are presenting should have three characteristics. It should be the property of the provable property bearer. Provable property bearer means you can say it is something like disputed property bearer, about which there is a dispute. About hill there is a dispute. Indians are acquainted with dispute over Ram Mandir. So in a particular area, whether Ram Mandir should be built or not, this is a dispute. So that becomes a disputed area. Similarly, hill here is a disputed area. And what is the dispute? Whether fire exists there or not. And then for that, somebody is providing a reason that here there is smoke and therefore there must be fire. So now this reason has to fulfill certain conditions, only then that reason will be a good reason. Otherwise it will be a bad, if it is a bad reason, then it will not be able to establish what we want to establish, that is that there is a fire. Now you are, this smoke is supposed to be a good reason. Why? Because it fulfills, according to Dinnaga, it fulfills three conditions. What are the three conditions? The smoke is there on the hill. This is the first. It should be on the hill. Otherwise, if it is not there on the hill at all, if it is somewhere else and not on the hill, then you will not be able to establish that there is fire on the hill. So first condition is that it should be the property, existence in the provable property bearer, means that reason property should be the property of the disputed property bearer. Provable property bearer means the property bearer which is to be proved as possessing the target property. Then existence in similar cases and non-existence in dissimilar cases. So here again the original terms are sapaksha and vipaksha. Similar cases, sapaksha; dissimilar cases, vipaksha. So I think for this we will have to use the board. And
is the what I have called provable property bearer. property there. And what I want to prove there, target property. Target property is to be proved. Now once these two things are given, I can divide the universe.
Universe, of course, here means the known world, because it is possible that beyond my knowledge, I mean, I cannot claim to be omniscient and nobody is omniscient. But insofar as the known world is concerned, I can divide this world into two parts. Those objects which possess target property, those objects which do not possess target property. Now, those objects which possess target property, I can consider the class of such property, such objects, and all these objects are actually property bearers. So, there will be a class of property bearers which possess target property and class of property bearers which do not possess target property. And there is an object about which I don't know whether it possesses target property or it does not target property, which is that object. This is the object, this is paksha. So all those places where about which we, I don't know whether it is, of course in this particular context it is only hill about which I am concerned. So hill is the thing where I don't know whether fire is there or not, but in my field of knowledge, that field of knowledge will be divided into two parts. The places where fire is there, the places where fire is not there. Now, all the places where fire is there will be similar cases. They will be called sapaksha, means similar cases. So, here similar cases is to be taken as a technical term, not similar in general. And all the places where fire is not there, they will be called dissimilar cases, that is vipaksha. So this is the first step that we have to take. Given any inference, it should be possible for us to identify sapaksha and vipaksha. Similar cases, dissimilar cases, conceptually, not necessarily in terms of particular cases. But what is sapaksha in the case of smoke fire? Fire possessing places. Wherever there is fire, known, we know that there is fire, all those places will be sapaksha, and where fire is not there, that will be vipaksha. Now, the three features or three characteristics follow after that. First, we are identifying similar and dissimilar cases. Now, the Dinnaga is saying that the reason property, that is hetu, should fulfill three conditions. It should exist in paksha. Similarly, it should exist in similar cases. That is, there should be at least some fire possessing places where smoke is there. Smoke should not be totally absent from fire possessing places. At least in some places it should be there. And it should not be there where fire is not there. It should not exist in dissimilar cases. And here we are saying that it should not exist in any dissimilar case. In the case of similar cases, we are saying that it should exist in at least some similar cases. We are not saying that the reason property should exist in every similar case. But we are saying that it should exist at least in some similar cases. That is, it could exist in a part of the class of similar cases, or in the whole of the class of the similar cases. But in the case of Vipaksha, that is dissimilar cases, Dinnaga is saying that it should not exist in any dissimilar case. It should be totally absent from the class of dissimilar cases. Why? Because suppose it exists in dissimilar cases, even in a single dissimilar case, what does it mean? That there is a situation where this smoke exists but fire does not exist. The reason property exists but target property does not exist. And this particular case is the supposed to be the case of deviation. The word for that is vyabhichara. Hetu exists but sadhya does not exist. Reason property exists but target property does not exist. It is a counter example. And if we have a counter example of this type, then naturally we will say that here also there can be like that. Here reason property exists but target property may not exist, because we have a case here where reason property exists without the target property. So we should not have any such counter example, which means that in Vipaksha cases, in dissimilar cases, this reason property should be totally absent. It should not exist anywhere in the dissimilar cases. So this is the meaning of the three features or three characteristics. Here the three terms, provable property bearer, now this may be a repetition, but I will read. Provable property bearer, that is paksha, class of similar cases, sapaksha, and class of dissimilar cases, vipaksha, should be understood properly. Every inference divides the universe of discourse in three parts. Provable property bearer, it is the property bearer where it is yet to be known or decided whether the target property exists or not. The class of similar cases, it is the set of property bearers where the target property is known to be existent. And the class of dissimilar cases, it is a set of property bearers where the target property is known to be non-existent. The concepts can be clarified by referring to the case of smoke fire instance inference. Here fire is the target property. One infers fire on the hill is the provable property bearer, that is property bearer where it is to be known or decided whether fire exists there or not. In the remaining world, that is in the known world, there are two types of cases where fire is definitely present and those where fire is definitely absent. The former type of cases are called similar cases and the latter type of are called dissimilar cases, sapaksha and vipaksha. For example, fire is definitely there in the kitchen. In those days, fire was kept ever burning in the kitchen. Or fire could be produced in an iron ball by heating it. So the class of such cases, so in similar cases we have the cases like kitchen where fire was there and heated iron ball, also fire can be produced. That will also be included in the class of similar cases. Similarly, fire is definitely not there in the places like lake, waterfall lake. The class of such cases is the class of dissimilar cases. So in water we will not find fire, for example. So such cases are vipaksha cases. Now let us check whether smoke as the reason property fulfills Dinnaga's three conditions of a good reason property. The reason property should exist in the provable property bearer. Yes, the smoke exists on the hill. The reason property should exist in the class of similar cases. Yes, the smoke exists in the traditional kitchen. The reason property should not exist in the class of dissimilar cases. Yes, the smoke does not exist in the places like lake. The reason property smoke is in this way fulfills all the three conditions, since it can be called a good reason according to Dinnaga's standard. Here one point needs to be noted very clearly. When Dinnaga said that reason property should exist in similar cases, he did not mean that it should exist in every similar case. In other words, he did not mean that it should exist in the whole class of similar cases. he kept the possibility open that a good reason property can exist in one part of the class of similar cases and absent from the remaining part. In this particular example, for example, smoke exists in the kitchen, of course traditional kitchen. Nowadays kitchens are also smokeless, but in those days fire was produced through wood or coal, whatever, and naturally smoke was also there. But in hot iron ball where fire is produced, no smoke is there. So smoke, the condition that smoke should exist in similar cases does not mean that it should exist in all similar cases. It should exist in at least a few similar cases. He only expected that it should exist in at least a part of the class of similar cases. So we find exactly this situation in smoke fire case. Here, as we have seen, the class of similar cases consists of the examples such as traditional kitchen and the hot iron ball. Out of them, smoke exists in the kitchen, but it does not exist in the hot iron ball. Dinnaga rightly maintained that such a discrepancy with reference to the class of similar cases does not affect the soundness of the reason property. However, such an expectation cannot be made to the third condition, with reference to the third condition, namely non-existence in the class of dissimilar cases. If a reason property is not existent in some dissimilar cases but existent in some, then it will not be a good reason. Because if the reason property exists even in a single dissimilar case, then it will mean that there is a genuine possibility that the reason property can exist without target property. This makes the reason property inconclusive. So inconclusiveness is one of the fallacies according to Dinnaga. Dinnaga considered different logical possibilities of the reason property's existence, non-existence and partial existence in the classes of similar and dissimilar cases. This gave rise to Dinnaga's doctrine of the wheel of reasons, Hetu Chakra. Dinnaga's theory of the three features of the good reason property thus formed a part of his larger theory of the wheel of reasons. So he considered, in a sense, Dinnaga's theory of inference is a formal theory, formalized theory. But the problem is whether it can be regarded as the theory of deductive reasoning. Now, what many scholars of Indian philosophy have done is that they have tried to understand Dinnaga's theory as a theory of deductive reasoning, and I differ from that particular view. I mean, according to me, it is a kind of analogical reasoning, though it is a formalized type of analogical reasoning. Wheel of reasons covered, so this wheel of reasons gives us a larger picture of the possibility of existence of reason property in similar cases, dissimilar cases. What are the different possibilities? So that is given by the what is called wheel of reasons that we will see. If the reason property which exists in the provable property bearer does not exist in dissimilar cases at all, but exists in a class of similar cases, either in all the cases or in a few of them, then it is a good reason property. But if the reason property exists in both similar cases where it should exist and dissimilar cases where it should not exist, then it is inconclusive because of its commonness. I mean, it is regarded as sadharana anaikantika. That is, reason property is common to similar cases as well as dissimilar cases. This is something which should not be allowed. If it exists in both similar as well as dissimilar cases, then it is regarded as inconclusive. But what kind of inconclusive? Common inconclusive. So there are two types of inconclusive: common inconclusive and uncommon inconclusive. If on the other hand the reason property exists only on the provable property bearer, he also gives different examples, we cannot go into that. So suppose there is a reason property which exists only on the provable property bearer. It does not exist either in similar cases or in dissimilar cases. It does not exist outside at all. Then Actually, it should exist in at least a few similar cases, but it does not exist. It should not exist in dissimilar cases. It does not exist in dissimilar cases, all right, but it should have existed in at least a few similar cases, which it does not do, and therefore it is also a kind of inconclusive reason, but it will be uncommon, inconclusive. Asadharana anaikantika. The earlier was sadharana anaikantika because it exists in both similar as well as dissimilar cases. Now this is something which exists neither in similar cases nor in dissimilar cases, and therefore it is called uncommon, inconclusive. So this is about the first paragraph I will not read now, but there could be a reason which does exactly opposite of what it should do. It does not exist in similar cases at all, where it should exist at least partially, but it exists in dissimilar cases, either wholly or partially, where it should not exist at all. Such a reason is called contrary, viruddha, because it proves, instead of the target property, the absence of it. The wheel of reasons may be demonstrated in the form of 3x3 matrix as follows. So here we have existence of reason property in, so the three columns refer to whole class of similar cases, so the reason property may exist in whole class of similar cases or part of the class of similar cases or no similar case at all. And with reference to dissimilar cases also, the reason property may exist in the whole classes of similar cases, part of the class of dissimilar cases, or in no dissimilar case at all. And then in these different situations, we have 9 combinations in all, and in each combination we can examine whether it refers to a good reason or a bad reason, and if it refers to a bad reason, then what kind of bad reason. So we will find that number 7 and number 8 are referred to good reasons. Why? Because in number 7, the reason property exists in no dissimilar case, and it exists in the whole class of similar cases. And number 8 is also a good reason because it does not exist in any dissimilar case, and it exists in similar cases, although in a part of the class of similar cases. And this satisfies the requirement of a good reason. So these are the two good reasons. All others are bad reasons in some way or the other. If it exists in, so number 1 is, it exists in both similar as well as dissimilar cases, so it is a common inconclusive. It exists in part of the class of similar cases, but whole class of dissimilar cases, again it is common inconclusive. And it does not exist in any similar case, but exists in dissimilar cases, it will be contrary, because it is exactly opposite of what it should do. And similarly, number 4, number 5 are also common inconclusive. Number 6 is contrary because it exists in no similar case. And number 9 is uncommon inconclusive because it exists in neither any similar case nor any dissimilar case, only in the provable property bearer. It should be noted that all the above types of reasons are supposed to be the properties of the provable property bearer. So this is a common assumption. He is not in this particular table, he is not considering the possibility that it is possible that hetu does not exist, that the reason property does not exist in the provable property bearer at all. I mean, such situations are possible, and in that case it is also a fallacious reason property. And he acknowledges that type of fallacy also, what he calls unproved reason, that is asiddha hetvabhasa. So that will be the third hetvabhasa. So in all, according to Dinnaga, there are hetvabhasa means fallacy, fallacies of hetu, fallacies of reason property. So there are 3 fallacies of reason property according to him. One is unproved, second is inconclusive, and third is contrary, that is viruddha. So asiddha, that is unproved reason property, means the if the reason proper existence of reason property cannot be established in the provable property bearer, it is not there somehow, or it cannot be proved to be there, then that will be unproved type of fallacy. So that he is not considering in this particular table. He is assuming that now here he is considering reason property which exists in provable property bearer, and then what are the different possibilities. So that is, out of the three conditions of the good, of a good reason, the first condition is already fulfilled in the above cases, and the question is about the second and the third condition. Hence, applying the three feature criterion to the above table of nine reasons or the wheel of reasons, it can be said that the seventh and the eighth type of reason are the good reasons, and the remaining seven are fallacious, inasmuch as they are either inconclusive or contrary. The doctrines of triple character of the reason and the doctrine of wheel of reasons give us the theory of strong analogical reasoning. The reason property can be understood as signifying analogy, and the target property as signified analogy. The reason property signifies the target property, it should be through, I think, through its association with the class of similar cases and non-association with the class of dissimilar cases. Dinnaga's other important, so this is about the theory of triple character of reason property. Now we come to other aspects of Dinnaga's theory. Dinnaga's other important contribution to the theory of inference is his classification of inference into inference for one's own sake and inference for others. We have seen that while discussing Nyaya, the inferential knowledge by which the individual himself apprehends an object is regarded as inference for one's own sake, whereas the inference which is made to in order that another individual apprehends the object is regarded as the inference for the sake of others. The distinction between inference for oneself and inference for others, which Dinnaga introduced, was not entirely new. Gautama and Vatsyayana had implied such a distinction, but Dinnaga presented it in an explicit and systematic way. Secondly, the way Nayayikas made the distinction is different from the way Buddhists made it. Two differences are relevant here. One question, can both be called anumana in the same sense or in different senses? This is one question about that, that is inference for oneself and inference for others. According to Nyaya, the two types of inference can be called inference in the same sense, but according to Dinnaga and also Dharmakirti, only inference for oneself is inference, that is inferential knowledge in the strict sense of the term. Inference for others is of the nature of an argument, which is linguistic in nature. It is not of the nature of knowledge. Hence, it can be called inference only in the secondary sense. So, argument itself is not regarded as inference as pramana, anumana pramana, because pramana is knowledge and argument itself is not knowledge. Argument can be an outcome of knowledge, it can generate knowledge, it can be the cause of knowledge, it can be the effect of knowledge, but it is not knowledge itself. And therefore, inference for others is not anumana pramana in the true sense of the term or in the primary sense of the term. It can be regarded as anumana pramana only in the secondary sense, not in the primary sense. Then, second question is, are the two processes parallel or isomorphic? We have seen in the first lecture the two types of inferences for Nyaya refer to two processes which are parallel or isomorphic in nature. According to Dinnaga and also according to Dharmakirti, the two processes are related by causal relation, but they are neither parallel nor isomorphic. That is, we saw that in Nyaya's system there is something like one-to-one correspondence between the steps in the inference for oneself and the steps in the inference for others. In the steps in the inference for others, first there is declaration, then after that presentation of reason property, then the invariable concomitance, then application of that invariable concomitance to the particular situation, and the conclusion. And corresponding to that, Nayayikas argued that in the inference for oneself also, similar process must be taking place. That is, first we have, of course, corresponding to declaration, there cannot be anything in inference for oneself, because one doesn't already know what one is going to know. Whereas in the case of inference for others, one can first declare what one is going to prove. But for in inference for oneself, first one sees the reason property in the property bearer, then one recollects this invariable concomitance, and at the third stage, the third stage was not accepted from Udyotakara in Ayyayika of 4th century, Udyotakara onwards, 4th, 5th century, Udyotakara onwards this was accepted, and then why? Because they wanted that there should be isomorphism between the two situations, that is inference for oneself and inference for others. So in inference of oneself also, after we recollect the invariable concomitance, that invariable concomitance should be applied to the present situation, and that should be the additional stage in the cognitive process. And that stage was we have translated it as consideration, it was called paramarsha. And then ultimately we have the knowledge of the target property. So four stages in inference for oneself, and four steps, the last four steps in inference for others, there is a kind of parallelism between them. Whereas for Buddhists, there is no such parallelism is required. I mean, even the so-called knowledge of vyapti relation, the knowledge of invariable concomitance or recollection of invariable concomitance, such steps can take place at subconscious level. One may just see the property, reason property, and immediately infer that there must be the target property. Now, when it comes to justification, then all these steps are required. One has to present, but not all these steps. Again, about that also there was a problem. Is it necessary to present all the five steps as Nayayika said, or only three steps are sufficient, only two steps are sufficient? So for Dinnaga, only three steps are sufficient. For Dharmakirti, only two steps are sufficient. So that, of course, we will see. But the inference for others has to have three steps according to Dinnaga: thesis, reason, and instance, paksha, hetu, and drushtanta. The nature of sadhana and its constituents. The propositions constituting the inference for others are regarded by Dinnaga as proof, sadhana. Proof stands for the whole body of inference consisting of three propositions, thesis, reason, and instance, since they enable the other person to apprehend the object which had not been apprehended either earlier. So, world is non-eternal because it is a product. I mean, just an example which is often quoted and used in theory of inference, particularly in Dinnaga's theory of inference. So, world is non-eternal because it is a product. That which is a product is non-eternal, like a jar. And that which is eternal is a non-product, like space. So here, world is non-eternal is the thesis. Because it is a product, it is the reason. Then, and the general statement, which with the illustration of jar or space, is the instance. So here, in the what is called instance, includes a general statement. And this general statement, of course, is the general statements based on observation and non-observation. It may be noted in this context that these three correspond to three steps: declaration, reason, and example in the five-step argument of the Nyaya school. So in the Nyaya school we have this five-step argument. Out of these five steps, only first is three steps are included in Dinnaga's framework. Since inference for others consists of three aspects, namely thesis, reason and instance, the theory of fallacies also becomes threefold according to Dinnaga. So there can be certain fallacies of thesis, there can be fallacies of reason and fallacies of instance. After Dinnaga, we find a tendency in the history of Indian logic to attach central importance to reason. Though the thesis, instance and their fallacies were also discussed in the later period, gradually their importance diminished and the whole credit and discredit of a good and bad inference respectively were thrust on reason. So fallacies of reason became central and fallacies of instance, fallacies of thesis, etc., they were not regarded as so important. Naturally, Dinnaga's theory of reason was both an object of appreciation and critical estimate in the later period. Hence, his theory of triple character, trirupya of reason, was taken seriously by the later logicians almost all the schools of Indian philosophy. Some logicians found the theory unduly restrictive because certain types of good inferences could not be accommodated by it. That is, these three characteristics, are all of them necessary? Are all of them sufficient? I mean, these were the questions raised later on. Or it is totally inadequate. This was the third. So these are the three different responses. Some logicians found the theory unduly restrictive because certain types of good reasons, good inferences which could not be accommodated by it. Some logicians found it unduly liberal because certain types of bad inferences could not be prevented by it. Hence, attempts were made to amend the theory. Some logicians found the theory totally inadequate and tried to replace the theory by another theory. Thank you.